Okay, a big question. Traditional treatments for carcinoid tumors, and carcinoid tumors, for those of you who aren't familiar with newly diagnosed patients, is a nickname for neuroendocrine tumors that start in the intestinal tract and the ones that start in the lung. The other ones are usually just called neuroendocrine tumor, and pathologists call them all neuroendocrine tumor. They don't even use the word carcinoid, so we have to think of carcinoid almost like a nickname for these tumors. Okay, so the traditional treatment is surgery whenever possible. If you have a tumor which is localized enough that it can be taken out surgically and you're otherwise a candidate for surgery, by all means, surgery is number one. Take it out, get rid of it. If the tumors have spread and it's possible to take out all or almost all of the disease, surgery is still a major option and is a good thing to do. Yes, nets of bronchioles. I presume she means nets of the bronchi, which are the same thing as lung neuroendocrine tumors. There also are nets that involve the tiny air vessels, the bronchioles and the alveoli. There's something called deep niche, which is diffuse neuroendocrine cell hyperplasia, diffuse pulmonary neuroendocrine cell hyperplasia, where you have tremendous increase in neuroendocrine cells all through the lungs. And this gives rise to lung carcinoids in many places throughout both lungs and can be treated with things like somatostatin analogs and other things if they need to be, and can interfere with lung function as well as cause carcinoids to grow. The term bronchial carcinoid and lung carcinoid are synonymous, and those things are treated with surgical resection if it's resectable, which many of them are. And if they're not resectable or there's recurrent or residual disease, they can be treated with other things like somatostatin analogs, everolimus, PRRT. There are different things that could be used if needed. That's a really difficult question because there really is no good long-term data on sandostatin, which is the same as octreotide, a triotide LAR for treating carcinoid tumors. We know that people can have control of their cancer for a really long time, but the only really good long-term follow-up data that we can rely upon is with lanreotide. And as I mentioned earlier, the average time the cancer can be controlled with lanreotide for carcinoid tumors in the intestine is about 61 and a half months, although for other sites it may be slightly less than that, but it can control cancer for years. It's a good question. It really could be either. It's not a terribly common side effect of either one, but it certainly can happen. If you have it and it gets better with your lanreotide, then you know it was a part of the carcinoid syndrome. If you never had it and you got lanreotide, and now it happens, then you can say, well, it was probably from the lanreotide. Well, I presume if it's in liver and pancreas, this was a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor which spread to liver. So you need to treat the neuroendocrine cancer as a whole. You need to treat it in both places. If it's no place else except liver and pancreas, pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors can still be treated with medications and are uniquely responsive to medications. The combination known as CAPE-TEM, capecitabine, which is also known as Zoloda, plus temozolomide, also known as Temodor, that combination of pill chemotherapy can result in a really major shrinkage of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. Can be used in addition, other things are available, like somatostatin analogs if the gallium dotatate PET is positive. PRRT can be used if necessary. Sunitinib, Sutent is another drug which is available. There are multiple things that can be done. In addition, depending on where it is in the pancreas, surgery is always something to consider doing. Even in the presence of metastatic disease, if the tumors in the liver can be treated at the same time or as well, there might be a role for surgery. Pancreas surgery is much safer and easier if the tumors in the so-called tail of the pancreas instead of the head, because the operation is less radical and has generally fewer problems. Tumors in the liver, depending on how many and where they are, can be surgically resected, be treated with embolization, as we mentioned, ablation, and liver-directed therapies like that, or they can be well treated by using medications, depending on the extent of the cancer and what is going on. One of the important things to remember is if you have a tumor in the head of the pancreas, and you have a head of the pancreas removed, it's called a Whipple operation. After that's done, it's not a good idea to do hepatic artery embolization because there's a high risk of getting liver abscesses. So if you're going to have embolization of the liver, that should be done before the Whipple operation rather than after. But other than that, the principles of cancer treatment with tumors in the pancreas and liver are similar to what we've been talking about for neuroendocrine tumors in general. Yes, there are certainly other drugs if everolimus can't be tolerated, but everolimus has gotten a lot of bad press and people have had horrible reactions to it, which is why it does have bad press in many cases, but a lot of it is unnecessary. The way everolimus can optimally be dosed is to not just give everybody the full dose of 10 milligrams per day, which is the recommended starting dose, but to adjust according to the person's metabolism and their situation and how they tolerate it. And a lot of people can't tolerate more than 5 milligrams a day or even 2.5 milligrams a day. And if you get the dose right for the particular person, most people can do fine on it. I've had people that were just incapacitated with horrible fatigue and diarrhea and skin rash and mouth sores and all kinds of side effects on a full dose. And then when they went on a lower dose, just were able to have their tumor control for years and years with excellent quality of life. So rather than just saying everolimus is not for me, you have to always ask the question, has the everolimus been dosed properly for you? Because what is proper for one person is not proper for another person. Now, there are certainly other treatments. We have investigational treatments in the case of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. We have sunitinib. We have other drugs for other kinds of neuroendocrine tumors. We have PRRT. We have surgery. But everolimus has a role, and if it's able to control the cancer without a lot of side effects, it's really good. But just many people are given a prescription for everolimus and told to come back next month and see their doctor. They come back next month and they can hardly walk and they're in a wheelchair or they just can't eat and they've lost 20 pounds. That's not the way to do it. When you start everolimus, you do it with the understanding that it can cause side effects. If they have side effects that are significant, you have to stop the drug for a little while. You wait for the side effects to get better. You discuss the situation with your doctor. And then when you're better from the side effects, you can restart at a lower dose. There are certainly some people who just can't tolerate it, but in my experience, if it's done very carefully, most people can.